नमस्कार, सभी का स्वागत है। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। आज हम बड़े शॉर्ट नोटिस पर मिलते हैं। आगे से हम हर शनिवार को 2 बजे क्लिनिकल रिसर्च के लिए जरूर मिलेंगे, जिससे हम क्लिनिकल रिसर्च के अलग अलग पहलुओं को अच्छी तरह समझ पाए और समाज को भी समझा पाए। यही हमारा इस कार्यक्रम के द्वारा उद्देश्य है। यह कार्यक्रम अभी YouTube पर लाइव है, जिससे आप अपने सर्कल में इसे बाद में सर्कुलेट कर लोगों का फायदा करा सकते हैं, लोगों को ज्ञान शेयर कर सकते हैं। टुडे इज 176th वेबिनार। वी आर मूविंग टुवर्ड्स 200 एंड बाय नेक्स्ट मंथ इट विल बी 200, मोर देन 200 वेबिनार्स। वी हैव कंडक्टेड दीज वेबिनार्स on moreover every day, which is being celebrated by UNO, WHO and national organizations to involve our Ayurveda to general society by various means, various topics. If you will go to the YouTube channel of Independent Research Ethics Society, you will find that every topic is being covered through Ayurveda, by Ayurveda, for Ayurveda, or of Ayurveda. So I am trying to make a bridge between society and definitely our Ayurveda. So now I would like to hand over mic to moderator, Mr. Darshit Joshi. Thankful to Dr. V. Ravi Shankar sir, my sir. Before 32 years also, he was teaching me in Jamnagar. So great Gurunam Guru, welcome Dr. Ravi Shankar sir, welcome Dheeraj ji, thank you Darshit ji, thank you Parikshit ji, Hari Om.
Thank you Pavan ji for your welcome address.
So let me welcome all of you of this 176th webinar, and in this webinar we are going to have the topic of guidelines in Ayush. We are having the best of best inaugurator with us, Dr. B. Ravi Shankar. If I give you a brief introduction of Dr. B. Ravi Shankar, he is the former director of SDM Center for Research in Ayurveda and Allied Science and professor of experimental medicine. With the great honor, he is also a former head of pharmacological laboratory in IPGT and RA Gujarat Arvind University, Jamnagar. Sir is, I don't have that much of, words to describe his glory. Okay, he has started his career with the assistant research officer in pharmacological department in Indian Institute of Panchkarma from Kerala. Okay, and later on, he was a research guidance as a guide and co-guide in highest number of scholars country in more than 250, research. He has provided his services to so many students. Okay, he involved in 25 plus project reports and served as a member of many government authorities and institutes. Okay, I really welcome Dr. B. Ravi Shankar to take this stage from me and just share his thoughts and his knowledge with us, and we'll be, very honored. Sir, Dr. B. Ravi Shankar, please.
So thank you very much, Dheeraj ji, for your kind introduction. At the outset, I would like to thank the office bearers, the organization people in IRES for inviting me to share this platform. It gives me immense pleasure to interact with the younger generation, to whom I would like to, based on my experience of past 40, more than 40 years, the few things I have noticed I would like to pass on to them. So that forms the basis. Some tremendous advances have occurred in biology, all walks of biological sciences, and especially the role of big data and virtual computer based programs are increasingly being introduced. So taking that into consideration, I will briefly highlight each of them though it would require at least 3 to 4 hours to cover the entire gamut of issues which are you know, which exist. So I would like to begin by sharing my screen.
Sir, can you please make Dr. B. Ravishankar a host so he can share the screen?
Yes, sir, done.
Ravishankar, sir, now you can see the green share screen option below the panel. So you can start.
Can you see my screen? Is my screen visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So the theme is the current trends in pharmacological research, the advances that are taking place in the not only in the field of pharmacological research, all sciences which are all allied sciences, I'd like to call them as allied sciences, with the allied with science of medicine, whether it is Ayurveda or allopathy. To begin with, we all categorize the research activities that are undertaken in our sector, that is health sector, into three main domains. Biomedical sciences, this is the category in which most of the research that is being done now. Whether it is for diagnosis purpose, whether it is for prophylaxis purpose, whether it is for treatment purpose or symptomatic treatment purpose or survey, all these things, clinical survey, they fall into this category. Population-based studies involving huge number of sample size are not that frequent in our Ayurvedic sector. Only recently, all credit to Dr. Rajesh Koteja, he has initiated large-scale studies involving sample size of more than 80,000 to 1 lakh. So I think the result of that would encourage others to undertake this thing, because in Ayurveda, we have a tremendous concept related to all aspects of healthcare, even for epidemic and pandemic, Janapodamsha. That concept, if we rigorously follow the Rituchariya, Dinacharya and other practices which have been mentioned in Ayurveda, so the containment of pandemic could have been much, much more better. So this is one of the lacunas. We don't have demographic data. So we have 130 crore. We don't know which type of, and we have got all five types, major types of human races represented in one country. And we have all type of climatic zones. In spite of having all these things, we do not have any demographic data from Ayurvedic perspective. We don't know which type of prakriti wale and which type of sattva wale, because the capacity and the proneness to the disease differ from region to region. So we are not collected information of those things. So there is a great potential to undertake population-based sciences. So, and health policy sciences, unfortunately, not only in Ayurveda, there is no policy, research center for the health sector as a whole. There may be some section in the planning commission doing that work, but a dedicated team of researchers fully devoted, what type of research should be undertaken for creating health policy? Creation of health policy is also very, very important. So this is the area where we are lacking. We need to create a policy research center for health sector in general and Ayurveda in particular. And now coming to the remarkable advances that are taken, extraction techniques have become fantastic. Supercritical extraction to SPS, you name them, but they are not relevant to Ayurveda from classical Ayurvedic point of view, but they are relevant to us when we conduct research studies. So by conducting research studies with those extracts, and then later on we can extrapolate the result to the formulations, and it can also be used for standardization purpose. standardization, Chinese have made remarkable, progress. They have heavily invested. They have created world-class institute, many world-class institutes for the research in traditional Chinese medicine. But unfortunately, in India, we do not have that infrastructural facility. Hyphenated system have come, big data analysis has come. In one of their formulation, they've identified, 12 lakh active principles in one formulation, they have employed PCA type of statistical analysis to, distinguish between different formulation. I think that kind of studies have not been initiated in our India. And drug discovery has remarkably changed. Earlier physiology profile-based research has given place to target-based research. But here, some of the Ayurvedic concept, they have got tremendous application. For example, the concept of Rasa Panchaka. In the next few slides, I'll be showing the importance of Rasa Panchaka, because taste receptors, research on taste receptors has increased, many fold. We get thousands of papers on that, this thing. I'll be briefly dwelling on that. Safety assessment, unfortunately, there are certain reservations, not only among non-Ayurvedic people, even among Ayurvedic people regarding the, use of mineral products, herbal mineral products, thinking that they are equivalent to the heavy metals. It is not so. Even whatever minimum studies they have been undertaken, no study says that the Ayurvedic heavy metal products are equivalent to heavy metal per se. So there is the definite definition. I will be showing some examples, and that's one area where we need to do a lot of things and apply the latest technique. And latest techniques are in our favor. The only thing is we need to apply them and generate a lot of huge data, so to show to the world that our mineral and herbal mineral products are as safe as any other drug in the market. And of late, network pharmacology and virtual screening, system biology experts are have been employed in a huge scale in traditional Chinese medicine, not in India. Few feeble attempts have made, that is only from point of view of active principle taken from medicinal plants, not involving the Ayurvedic concept of disease pathogenesis, or Ayurvedic concept of Rasa Panchaka, which is required for efficacy of a drug, and moreover the concept of Viruddhahara, the incompatibility. So such things have not been factored in. So that's why they are not entirely Ayurvedic in nature. But even in spite of these shortcomings, they are very helpful in coming out with new ideas and for generating new leads. So and macromolecules, most of our polypharmaceuticals, they contain medicinal plants and rarely animal products and minerals. So they have macromolecules like protein, polysaccharides, other complex lipid components in them. So they are the primary metabolite products of the plant, and their presence has not been taken into consideration at all. And the data generated during the few decades shows that they play a very important role. So this is among these few areas I'll be focusing in the next few this thing. So Rasa Panchaka, not much has been done, but taste receptor physiology has advanced tremendously. A decade back, so this paper has been published, by a well-known research team, and it was published in Nature Medicine, So in that, they were working on the taste receptors. They were working on taste receptors. While doing so, they came across presence of bitter taste receptors in the airway. So everybody were under the impression that taste receptors are present in taste buds, not in the other this thing. Even if they are present, they are redundant. They thought physiologically they may be redundant. So they were curious to know what is the need of presence of this bitter taste receptor in airway. So when they identified, they thought they began with the hypothesis that this bitter taste receptor, when they exposed to unwanted material through airway, they will constrict and prevent the entry of such things into the lung. But actual study was carried out, they found that instead of constriction, powerful relaxation occurred after administration of bitter testing principles. Then they further undertook detailed in vitro in vivo studies, which I am not going to talk now related to them. So, but what I want to mention here is that...
Sir, your screen is not visible.
Is it?
Yes. Previously, it was visible, sir.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Now it is visible, sir.
But it is in hyperlink. That's why it is probably it is not visible. So I will directly go to that Rasa Panchaka concept evidence. Now
it is visible, sir.
This is what I was talking. So
not Rasa Panchaka. It is first slide visible.
Oh, not Rasa Panchaka.
No, first slide is visible.
Oh. So there may be some distinct.
You can reshare.
Now, is it visible?
Yes.
Yeah. It is Rasa Panchaka concept evidence.
Yeah. So,
it is visible now.
So, they found out that, this bitter taste receptor, the bitter taste compounds, they are releasing calcium, and this calcium is acting on the rectified potassium channel. And that rectified potassium channel acting on airway smooth muscle to produce hyperpolarization, because of that very powerful relaxation occurred. So now, and later on, now they have identified 25 type of bitter receptors. Can you imagine 25 type of bitter receptors alone? In addition to that, receptors are there for, sweet taste. They are present on different organs like GI tract, sperm, skeletal muscles, CNS, bone marrow, blood vessels. And, there's one receptor known as Onillate receptor. Our Kattu Pradhana Dravyas, they act through this Onillate receptor. And this Onillate receptor, they control the fundamental ion channel known as TRPV channel, which are present in every cell. Now they say that taste receptors are present in almost all the cells. So that's why this concept of discrete chemosensory system has come. So like that, I have material which can be, discussed for nearly an hour. So now they have identified the role of taste receptor on different aspect in diabetes, in bowel, in this inflammatory bowel disease, impact on longevity. Not only that, some people consume alcohol consumption because of the inappropriate bitter receptor present in them. So like that, taste receptor physiology has come, but unfortunately, no study has been undertaken from an Ayurvedic point of view. So this is one of the very fertile areas,
Yes, ma'am.
So which has got tremendous potential for future studies. So I think I'm back to the presentation, right?
No.
Okay, I think my PPT is maybe visible now.
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Yeah. The another important aspect which I like, I would like to show you is that, is the slide visible now? I mean the word this thing write up traditional system medicine.
No, sir, it's not visible at this moment. Previously, it is visible.
Four o'clock.
Now I think it is visible, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this traditional system medicine, the safety aspect, as I already mentioned. So currently available, I would like to point this out to the regulators, international regulators. So the currently available guidelines are not ideal for us because they are mainly meant for single active principle based synthetic drugs. Whereas we are using the complex multifactorial or multi-component thing, and their drug-body interaction, we don't know. Mechanism of multi-component drugs, we don't know. Involvement of multiple pathways, we don't know. There are maybe multiple targets. So this, it is totally unsuitable for us. Recently, Chinese scientists have you know, they have come out with a strategy in which they come with a combination of toxicological genomics, metabolomics, and also molecular toxicology, model organism, receptor pathways, all these things they took into consideration, and they have created a platform for early stage safety prediction. For example, like our Viruddha concept, they have got 18 medicine known as 18 incompatible medicaments. So these 18, two of them should not be present in the same formulation. So taking that concept into consideration, they've added a newer concept like the probable interaction with the pregnant X receptor. This receptor is involved in intense manner with the drug metabolism. So like that, so they have created and have identified biomarkers, biomarker screening also done. They have identified 10 for the heart, 5 for kidney, and 10 for liver. And they have also identified some of the metabolites, they come up, that may possibly arise when mineral products are consumed. So in another study, they studied pure mercurials like mercury chloride, mercury methyl mercury, and compared with Zuda, traditional medicinal system. So they studied on the renal and hepatic transporters and renal expellers, and also genes involved in that. So they observed that mercury chloride and methyl mercury affected they accelerated the transporters and decreased the activity of the expelling transporters. But this traditional system mineral product Zutai had no such activity. In another study, so a comparative study was done with mercury chloride and the classical Chinese formulation. They adapted this toxicogenomics. In toxicogenomics, the importance is that so we can predict that probable toxicity much before its phenotypic expression. That means it becomes apparent. So they studied all the parameters. They found that mercury chloride produced all degenerative changes, and mercury got accumulated in the different tissues. When the expression of sensitive gene was carried out, all the six genes, which are important from the point of view of toxicity sensing, were they got stimulated in case of mercury chloride, but not with the classical formulation. This clearly shows that there is a definite difference between the heavy metal per se and preparations which we use. So because of a temporal reason, I'll be skipping many of these slides. So whatever study we do, we should always get the authenticated material. Doing any study without authenticated material would be useless. So we should use all available techniques and this thing to standardize and authenticate the material which we use. In addition to that, technical non-drug therapy like panchakarma can also be evaluated. In one of our studies, we evaluated the role of test drug in that is neurohabasti. Neurohabasti was given in rats made hypothyroidic by injecting methimazole, and you can see the changes which are made by methimazole were tremendously remarkably reversed by neurohabasti. So we carried out histopathology and many other investigation also. This is the normal one. After giving methimazole, the thyroid gets collapses, and all the structural details will go, and it was restored when neurohabasti was given. So this is one example. We like this. We have studied the efficacy of Basti and Parkinsonism and even on hemiplegia induced by carotid artery ligation. So like that experiment can be conducted in vivo, in vitro, X5O. And it can be used as adjuvant. Many of our formulation can be used as adjuvants with other system of medicine. There was a clinical study we carried out at a PhD level in Jamnagar, in which traditional formulation was combined with anti-tubercular drug, and a clinical study was investigated. The results were amazing. The adverse effect because of the anti-tubercular drug tremendously reduced. The sputum negativity also greatly reduced. And moreover, the dose required, the bioavailability also got enhanced. This we did with the help of a clinical research organization of Ahmedabad. So many experimental studies are available to show this. Traditionally, we can also use the advances in pharmacological research to test some of the hypotheses. For example, the influence of place of collection has been mentioned. In one of the studies we studied, the influence of place of collection, we found that Anupadesha sample collected from Ratnagiri was found to be better in comparison to the Jangaladesha sample. And the seasonal variation also has got great impact. One of the studies, the September sample was found to be producing very good effect, whereas November and July samples were almost ineffective. So, and Silajit, one of our most important drugs. So we compared six samples taken from different regions, and some of them were active and some of them were inactive when we screened for different activities. This slide shows the effect on antidepressant activity in mice immobility test. So bisajakalpana lot of changes are being made in formulation studies. In one of the studies, we compare the efficacy of the three different type of formulation methods for same formulation, panchatiktagrita. So panchatiktagrita with tripalakalka and without murchana, and one of them was there, and the result showed that the panchatiktagrita without murchana and without kalka produced remarkable stimulation in antibody formation, whereas the effect was less in other two type of formulation. So in another study, comparison between Avaleha and Arista was conducted, and for Kutaja and Kutaja Avaleha was found to be more effective in comparison to Arista, though Arista also produced a moderate effect. And the concept of Sodhana is very well ingrained in Ayurvedic formulation methods. So in one of the study, we studied non-purified and purified Gloriosa superba Langley. So non-purified or unpurified samples, so they produced a significant decrease in spermatogenesis, degenerative changes in the testes, whereas after Sodhana it was opposite. So they almost produced a Russia-like effect. So and curcumin has been found to produce one of the most important effect. It influences all the epigenetic factors which are involved: microRNA formation, demethylation, DNA methylation, deacetylation, and acetylation. All the four epigenetic modalities were found to be influenced by curcumin, one of our golden molecules. Unfortunately, its bioavailability is very poor. So in one of the studies, it was shown that the crude extract acts at the involved concept of network pharmacology. So the isolates produced the effect at different nodes level, but the crude extract acted at the hub level, modulating all the pathways. So in one of them, neuron regeneration activity was neuron plasticity activity was assessed in Bacopa and Central Asiatica, in which it was clearly observed and clearly documented that it promotes formation of proliferation of neuron, this thing. And not only that, as a unique mechanism, so some of our product, especially the phenicic acid of obtained from pomegranate, it influences a very important transcription factor known as PPAR, paroxysmal proliferating activated receptor. So it has got a very important regulatory role in all the systems. In most of the system, it plays a protective role, and that being stimulated, it's an important evidence for the unique mechanism of our drugs. Similarly, you know, number of drugs and their mechanism of action has been enumerated. So they inhibit entry of virus. So they inhibit the activity of oncogenic gene activation. They inhibit a number of pathways which are involved in controlling cell cycle related activities. So biomarker, I said polysaccharides, protein, nucleic acid, like that. So they all have important activity, especially on immune system. So that this aspect needs to be evaluated. So we have this thing, and finally I would like to wind up my talk by showing this study. So an important study in which in silico study followed by in vitro approach has been adopted by this group of investigators in a very important study, sort of a landmark study in case of in silico studies in Ayurveda. So they studied the effect of triple on angiogenesis. First of all, gathered information about the phytochemical they gathered information about this triphala phytochemical this thing. So there were hundreds of them, and from them, among them, so they identified which have got drug-like activity by employing Lipinski's rule. And from then they selected the protein target which are related to angiogenesis, and also other protein targets in relation to inflammation, immunomodulation. And using the latest approaches, they conducted virtual screening through docking, and so they found that out of them, 15 molecules have got this angiogenic promoting activity, and they add tremendously to the angiogenesis promoting activity of triphala. So they also studied the effect on inflammation, and also on the molecules responsible for that. And finally, they carried out studies with biomarkers like CD31 and E-selectin. These are the biomarkers for angiogenesis, and both of them were found to be modified by this triphala components. Later on, they carried out actual research studies to show that components have got efficacy in vitro conditions. So these are the type of studies which would be very, very helpful, and which require active this thing. And finally, it's very, very important to publish our results in internationally recognized journals. For that, we need to follow guidelines. For example, we have a well-known guideline in the form of ARRIVE, so which can be followed, similar to CONSORT statement. Finally, another point I would like to make is that, so in the statistical application now, the p-value based and say a significant level assessment is being slowly relegated to the background nowadays. What they call is effect size calculation. So our studies should in whatever result we get should be converted into effect size calculation based modalities. So they have got Cohen's D calculation and another five methods, and they can be adapted, and results should be interpreted from that angle, because they are clinically more relevant. A drug may be statistically significant, it may not produce the significant effect clinically, and vice versa. So adapting this effect size calculation to our clinical studies is very, very important. Of course, in future speakers, you know, the which are scheduled in the next week, they will cover all this aspect. So with this, I would like to, you know, end my this brief, you know, interaction with you. Urging that Ayurveda has got tremendous value, both from the concept point of view and also from resource point of view. But that should be, you know, studied from Ayurvedic point of view. So we need to adopt Ayurvedic perspective as our goal. Research conducted by Ayurvedic people for Ayurveda, as Pavan was telling, Pavan Sharma was telling. So then only we can, you know, generate evidence to satisfy everybody. Nowadays we lack infrastructure. None of our institutions have got international level or even national level facilities. That's the lacuna. Enthusiastic research are there in hundreds, but they are not getting the opportunity. And the institutes which have got those facilities, they have got their own mandate, so they will not be able to provide time to our endeavors. So I request again to the administrator to create world-class infrastructure in the field of Ayurveda so that all our requirement can be met. So thank you very much, and I wish all the best to the future generation of Ayurvedic researchers.
Thank you sir, excellent, great Gurudev, great. I would like to request you for your 1 hour lecture in our next webinars, so it will have some time, enough time, satisfactory time to explain. But excellent, sir, excellent. Absolutely. You are Gurunam Guru.
Absolutely, sir. And starting from the policy research center to in-depth knowledge in pharmacological for the receptors and everything. Being a college students, we can understand that how depth sir was interacting with us and how technical it was in compared to the current research and current clinical research are going on. Now I would like to request Dr. Pavan Sharma, who is the president of Independent Research Ethics Society, to take this stage and share his knowledge and guide us further for this today's webinar. Thank you, sir. Over to you, sir.
Before starting, I would like to welcome Professor Madan Thangveluji from UK, Dr. Yunus Munsi, Director, RRI Unani Medicine here, Research, Dr. Arjun Baghel from Jamnagar, Dr. Ghalib also observed. Yes, welcome all. Dr. Uday Shankar, welcome all. Now I would like to highlight some other point of this Ayush research, because today now guidelines have been issued. Various guidelines, a series of guidelines have been issued for Ayurveda. If we say roads are different, goal is same. Maybe ICMR, maybe WHO, maybe OECD Association, maybe CDSCO. Goal is patient safety. Simple goal, patient safety. GCP is a set of guidelines for design, conduct, termination, audit, analysis, reporting, and documentation of the studies involving human subjects. Fundamental tenet 2, science at any point of the time should not taken as granted and harm the subject. Previously, it was the various examples were observed where patients were harmed during clinical trial. So now it is strict, rigid, and for beneficial for the patient subject. Ensure that studies are scientifically and ethically sound. Clinical properties of ASU medicine under investigation are properly documented. If science is taken granted that it is suicide, nothing is to be told. 2 cardinal principles. Why? Protection of the right of human subject, number 1. Authenticity of ASU medicine clinical trial data generated. Guidelines are now renovated in corona pandemic, and various guidelines are issued already. Like this, general guidelines for clinical evaluation of Ayurvedic intervention. It is issued by Central CCRAS. It is volume 3. Before this also, volume 1 and volume 2 were published for drug development and for preclinical trials. Now I would like to hear, this is the development of pharmacopoeia according to our government, CCRAS, right from 3000 BC to 1000 BC, plants, how it was observed, I don't know, but Vedic text, in Vedic text 289, plants are observed, Atharvaveda. 1500 BC and 500 AD, 650 plants in Sanhitas, and then 2000 plants in 16 major Nigantus like Dhanvantari Nigantu, Bhavaprakash Nigantu, etc. If we say the flowchart of clinical researches, so both is there in researches, diagnosis based on modern methods as well as Ayurvedic principles, Prakriti, Dosha, Dushya, etc. Therapeutic classification, conventional Ayurvedic. Then controlled clinical observation, combined results, conventional on conventional methods, and analysis based on Ayurvedic principles. It is newly added in our clinical researches of ASU medicines. We were practicing it from last 3 decades. That is a separate issue, but government also has also recognized it and added to the protocol of Ayurvedic research. Stage 2, expanded therapeutic use and mechanism of action, traditional versus modern. If we talk about preparatory phase, survey, SOP, design of study, formulation, clinical protocols, all are the steps. This series is started to explain these points in detail, one by one, for clinical research experts, for clinical research aspirants, or for clinical research workers, persons, staffs, pharmacologists. Everybody will be benefited by this series, GCP series. So it will be discussed in detail in next webinars. But then also, preparatory phase is there, drug development phase is there, and then execution of clinical trial come into the picture. Researches, as we all know, this is also in Ayurveda also. First, enlisting the use, then literary research, then ethnopharmacognostic, agrobotanical details, proven herbs or plants probably medicinal. Two types of classification has been done by guidelines, that proven herbs, so we can move ahead on second step, dosage forms, then standardization, then again dosage form, and then quality control parameters or methodology. If that plant is probably medicinal, then clinical evaluation, animal experimentation, pharmacodynamic and pharmacokinetic observations, toxicity data, if it is warranted by experimental studies. That is also if it is safe in animal experimentation, then toxicity data may not be required in such a way. Active principles, isolation, identification, purification, then molecular manipulation, low priority. Ayurvedic deals with holistic approach generally, so the molecular stage of manipulation is very less and rare. Then, folklore medicine. If folklore medicine is there, so observation, what they are doing, how they are using, then clinical evaluation preliminary for validating claims, then identification of raw material, pharmacology. It should be first actually, before clinical evaluation, the identification of raw material and pharmacognosy should be done before the clinical evaluation. standardization and quality control, and then preclinical study. Preclinical study, it is very necessary because those claims mentioned by local Vaidyas, traditional Vaidyas, should be validated on scientific parameters. It is very necessary. So, large-scale clinical trial then, sometimes, preparation of appropriate dosage form. It is observed that local Vaidyas are prescribing in which dose, and on the basis of that dose, we should also decide that dose after standardization of the medicine, and then large-scale clinical trial for new drug, because that may be medicinal, that may not be medicinal, but if some medicinal properties have been observed, then it should be trial on huge human population. Protocol should not be more than 1 to 2 pages as per the guidelines, and these points should be included. Well, all these guidelines are available in the net, but it is very essential to understand the points as well. So, while formulating protocol, everything should be considered in mind, right from title, objective, outcome measures, what will be the outcome measures, population, phase, number of site, study design, then study duration, participants' participation duration, description of study intervention. It will not be 10 or 20 pages. Who has muted me? Darshit? Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
You're audible.
Okay. So estimated time to complete the enrollment and utility. What will be the utility of that particular scientific research for the society? It is also needed in that. Act means one act only, Drug and Cosmetic Act 1940. Adverse event, all we know, any untoward medical occurrence, that is a adverse event. ADR, all we know, adverse event and adverse drug reaction. These are two different aspects of the clinical research. ADR is directly related to the medicine, where AE, adverse event, may or may not be directly related to the medicine which we are prescribing for the trial. Audit of trial should be necessary for validating each and every steps process. Number one, whether we are rightly enrolling the patient, we are rightly filling ICF and CRFs and analyzing the data. So audit of a trial is very necessary as per the Act. Ayurveda, Siddha and Unani Act generally deals with two drugs. ASU drugs means classical drugs, generally mentioned in our 54 books of approved books of Schedule 1. And patent or proprietary medicine, that means in relation to ASU system of medicine, all formulation contain only such ingredient mentioned in the formulation described in the authoritative book. That means slight difference is there, slight observation difference is there, because these ingredients should have also be mentioned in those approved book of the relevant schedule. And 1.5 point is that those formulation which are mentioned in the drug text should be taken, should be followed religiously as per the text. That will be blinding, masking. We know for double blind, single blind, triple blind trials. So it should be taken for consideration. CRF, phase 1, phase 2 and phase 3 study. Generally, estimation of safety and tolerability with initial administration of ASU drug or other traditional medicine into humans, this is phase 1. Drugs with probable toxicity means in Schedule E, ingredients are usually studied in patients before making any formulation. So it is needed for drugs with some point of toxicity, some percentage of toxicity. Studies conducted in phase one usually intended to involve one or a combination of the following objective. Maximum tolerated dose, it is also very necessary. Early measurement of drug activity. So preliminary studies are dealing with that. And then phase two. So phase two trial is the to evaluate the effectiveness of an ASU drug for a particular indication or indications in patient with the condition under study and to determine the common short-term side effects. So this is actually, we are moving away and moving forward to the clinical research, and studies in phase two should be conducted in a group of patients who are selected by relatively narrow criteria. So selection criteria and exclusion criteria is very important. We should consider it most important before starting the clinical trial. What is our selection criteria, criteria of inclusion, and what is our exclusion criteria? These studies should be closely monitored. Dose regimen is decided from this phase second for phase three trial. Doses used in phase second are usually, but not always, less than the highest doses used in phase one. So doses are also being refined in these phases step by step. Additional objective of phase two studies can include evaluation of potential studies, endpoints, therapeutic regimens, etc., etc. for population. Phase three are designed to confirm the preliminary evidences accumulated in phase two that drug is safe and effective for use in the intended indication and recipient population. It may also help further explore the dose-response relationship, use of the drug in wider population, in different stages of disease, or the safety and efficacy of the drug in combination with other drugs. So these are main important points. I am not going into the detail. I am generally trying this to make it very short as words I view, because we are going to explain these one by one to explain to the society and interested person in very easy language and shant, calm language. The opinion poll was conducted by IMA, but it was not found safe. And so many doctors have written to Drug Controller of India to ban its use. So phase three, for ASU drugs approved outside India, phase three studies need to be carried permanent preliminary to generate evidences of efficacy and safety of the drug in Indian patients. Already that is approved outside of the India, but then also it phase three studies are needed in India for Indian population. It is to be remembered very seriously. Prior to conduct of phase three studies in Indian subject, licensing authority may require detailed safety studies if possible. And if possible, pharmacokinetic studies to be undertaken to verify the data generated in Indian population. Very nice. To validate the data from abroad, it is very necessary to conduct phase three trial of those approved formulation which are approved by any international body or other country. Phase four, PMS, post-marketing trials, are the studies other than routine surveillance performed after drug approval and related to approved indications. These trials go beyond the prior demonstration of drug's efficacy, safety, and dose definition. Because generally, this product has been launched already, public is using it, and then also manufacturer or the inventor needs some validation, needs observation that how my product is going on in the market. So these phase four trials are necessary. May not be considered necessary at the time of new drug approval, but may be required by the licensing authority for optimizing the drug use. It is very necessary. It may not be required for the licensing purpose, because for approval, before approval, if we are taking license, how can it is possible that we can conduct PMS before launching of the product? So phase four trials include additional drug-drug interaction, dose response, or safety study and trial designed to support use under the approved indication. For example, motility, morbidity studies, epidemiological studies, etc. One, Data and Safety Monitoring Board, DSMB board, charged with the monitoring the accumulating data of the pharmacotherapeutic clinical trial to detect and report early evidence of pre-specified or unanticipated benefit to harm the trial participant. So Data Safety Management Board is also necessary, and that board will look after the benefits of the safety of the human subjects. Interim analysis, any assessment of the data done during the patient enrollment and follow-up stages for a trial, that is interim analysis to be done. Vulnerable participant, any individual who lacks the ability to fully contribute to participate in the study is a vulnerable. Study design, information on Anupanam, this was not in GCP, in modern, Anupanam, Pathyam, Utkal Bhagu, prerequisite procedures, Vanti, Anjan, Nasya, various kalpanas are included now in ASU medicine, validation of ASU medicine. Inclusion-exclusion criteria, I have already briefed about that it is most important factor for clinical research, and the investigator or the CRO should concentrate to finalize inclusion and exclusion criteria very deeply, very thoroughly. Safety handling of ASU. Measures to be implemented to ensure the safe handling and storage of the ASU medicine. System to be followed for labeling of product, code, numbering, etc. Label should necessarily contain the following information in words: for clinical studies only, because that should not be marketed sample. That should not be any other sample which can be mixed or adulterated. So very clearly it should be described: batch, investigator, name of institution. So everything should be mentioned. ICF, as we all know, without informed consent form, any trial is illegal. You have to take informed consent of a participant. If participant is not of legal age, the guardian must have to submit this to the investigator. Nowadays, informed consent form is also recorded, video recorded. Otherwise, that was also being manipulated by the signature of the patients. So patient PIS, patient information sheet, to be given to the patient. After reading that patient information sheet carefully, he will or she will sign on the ICF. That is the first safety point of a doctor, of an investigator, that the patient has given permission of trial participation. Trial in children should always be carried out after the phase 3 clinical trial in adults, as we are also observing the during the trials of vaccines. Now, one by one, they are decreasing the age. So, parent or legal guardian of each child has given proxy consent. I have told you already. Research should be conducted in setting in which the child and parent can obtain adequate medical and psychological support. This is also very necessary. This is excellent support to the human subject, because father or mother along with the children definitely needs it. Assent, pediatric subjects are legally unable to provide written informed consent. So guardian is necessary. Where appropriate, pediatric participants should additionally assent to the enroll in the study. Mature minors and adolescents should personally sign and date separately design in separately design written assent form. So it is also very necessary to take this periodic safety update reports PSUR. It is essential in PMS post marketing surveillance. If we are doing, it is very easy. Number one, it is very important tool to monitor the progress and to monitor the toxic effect or medicinal effect of the drug which is being tested. Originally, ordinarily, all dosage forms and formulations as well as indications for new drugs should be covered in one PSUR. Investigator in Ayush trial. Every Ayurvedic doctor can be investigator for any trial. The investigator should be qualified by education, training, and experience. It is better to have postgraduate degree, but if it is not there, that does not mean that you can't be investigator. You can be investigator if you have a research interest, if you have a system of documentation and analysis, definitely you can present a research paper. There is no binding. So the investigator should be qualified by education, training, and experience to assume responsibility for the proper conduct of the study and should have qualifications prescribed by Central Council of Indian Medicine. However, the principal investigator should be from respective ASU system. The investigator should provide a copy of the curriculum with CV and other relevant documents requested by the sponsor or ethics committee. Ethics committee, very important role of ethics committee is there. I have also here CDSCO approved ethics committee, independent ethics committee, Clinical Research India. That is only independent ethics committee approved by CDSCO as per the constitution of CDSCO, not for Ayush, for all the medicine. We can validate those trials and we can approve those trials before starting. I'm member secretary of that for your kind information. He, she should be clearly understand the time and other resources demands the study is likely to make and ensure they can be made available throughout the duration of study. So investigator has main important lead role in the clinical trial. It cannot be ignored that he or she must have the best qualification, best experience, best a concept of observation. The investigator should also ensure that other studies do not divert essential subject or facilities away from the study at hand. So thank you, Hari Om. For today, it is sufficient. We will be meeting on every Saturday to explain these points in detail with various different experts of the line, like our Gurudev, Professor Ravi Shankar ji. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you all.
Well, it is Dr. Pawan Sharma. This is truly, in-depth guideline that you have made in a very simple language. Those who are right now joined and who will be, watching over the YouTube will clearly understand what is the ASU guideline for the clinical research. I'm very happy to, learn these things, though I know these things, but the way you have explained it, it is very clear now to everyone. Now I would like to request Dr. Dheeraj Patel. Dheeraj Patel is director of Vilisius Research Limited from Ahmedabad, and he will also be, guiding us for the, how to conduct the clinical trials in ASU, particularly in Ayush medicines. Over to you, Dr. Dheeraj, sir.
Thank you very much, Darshit, and Dr. Ravi Shankar and Dr. Pawan. It was very, very good presentations, especially Dr. Ravi Shankar. So there is so much depth in research on the many studies. So that is very, very good to know about the research going on for the Ayurveda. So So let me see the screen and yeah, that's it. Can you allow me to share the screen? Hello. Yeah, that's it. Can you allow me to share the screen?
Yes, we are doing it. We are doing it, sir. Just a minute.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah.
Just a minute, sir. You are about to get the co-host. Okay, give me 1 second.
Yeah.
फिर सर आप देखिए नीचे शायद आपको यस 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 नाउ इट इज देयर
या आई एम एबल टू
ओके ओके ग्रेट सर ग्रेट
या थैंक यू वेरी मच एंड गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन सो आई एम फ्रॉम वेलेसियस क्लिनिकल रिसर्च आई एम डूइंग द क्लिनिकल डेटा मैनेजमेंट टास्क ओवर हियर सो बेसिकली सो माय प्रेजेंटेशन वुड बी अराउंड द डेटा हैंडलिंग डेटा प्रोसेसिंग एंड डेटा कलेक्शन So to be around basically in the data, right? This just a introduction of the process we are following. That this is also part of the last session, but here I just want to reiterate the what is the process for the data set. That is about the gathering of the data. After gathering, there will be organizing of the data, and then once the data is organized in this particular media, then it should be analyzed in a proper way, and then it should be formatted in a proper way as per the guideline, and finally it should be structured that is suitable for the reviewer, inspector, or regulatory body reviewer, right? And all this process should be followed through SOPs. And I will just start from the last slide of our last session, that is about the ALCOA principle. Because in last session we just introduced this ALCOA, but I want to just explain the in detail about the ALCOA. So each words has some meaning. So we'll have the in detail discussion of ALCOA plus principle. You know, ALCOA stand for attributable, legible, contemporaneous, original, accurate, and plus means complete, consistent, and enduring. And available. Now, take you through the in detail meaning of this each and every word. Like A is like attributable. The message from this principle is who performed the action and when. If a record is changed and who did it, means each and every record should be attributable by the person who record the data, person who are authorized to. Collect the data. For example, in case of medical history or vital, it should be authorized. It should be collected by investigator only. So, in case of blood sample collection, it should be authorized or collected by phlebotomist. So, each and every record should be attributed by the person who are assigned for the records. So, obviously, there should be a date assigned and date when the data is recorded. And all the reports should be signed together. And in case of we are using the electronic system, then there will be a unique user ID for a particular study or project. So that is linked with all the data that we call as audit trail. So each and every data recorded on the system, that will be linked with your user ID. And we know that user ID must be required for maybe if you are using some net banking, so there is some customer ID, so that is your user ID. So each system, electronic system, carry the user ID with password. Why it is important? Because it's Based on that, we can trace the data to know that who performs the activity, whether the authorized person performs the activity or not, based on the signature and date, whether it is manipulated by or maybe recorded by other person who are not authorized to do the work. And we should also check whether the authorized person is trained on the work or not, like PI or designated person, like study coordinator, should be trained on the protocol, some SOPs before he or she performs the activity. And when reviewing the data, when our sponsor or sponsored data person go to the site, and they should review the data or whether that activity is performed by the person. So when reviewing the data, it should be ensured that activity is performed by the authorized person. And we also check the SOPs and responsibility authorization, right? And that will ensure that records are attributable to the person. Here we can see from this example that that patient details, that the correction in the patient details is authorized by person. So that sign and date should be in the log form, like the particular person, full name of the particular person in the separate log form. From there, we can able to trace that entries made by the person who are in the study. Going to the next word, that is legible. So what are the data recorded on the paper or maybe electronically? It should be legible. It should be in the legible language as well. It should also cover the language. It should not be in the local language. So local language is not legible to everyone. So common language is English, obviously. So it should be in the common language. And data must be recorded in a permanent, durable medium, and it should be readable. So we should use the permanent link ink only. So it should not be water link. So if water is drop on that, so data would not be lost. We should, in case of correction is there, then we should, user should or recorded should do the single line on the correct wrong data and make the changes along with that, what we have seen in the previous slide. So just need to put single line and do the correction and to provide the new data along with that. Why it is important? Well, the legibility, to allow the reconstruction of all the data modifications. So it might happen, so first recorded data might be wrong, later on mini-stickered or study person might see that there is a transcription error on that. So in case there is a correction on the data, so that's be a sign and date using the single cross line. That will reconstruct what was the first record, what was the second record, what were the third records. So that will allow to reconstruction of all the data modifications done on particular data field. Illegible data left impression that you are trying to do something hide. You are trying to hide something. Normally that is a habit. So if we are not aware about some of the process or that, we start writing the illegibility, right? Maybe in the exam paper. So that's the mentality, and that is the wrong practice in the research. So we should avoid that kind of process practice. When study personnel review the maybe sponsor representative, always check about the overwritten data. So overwritten data is not allowed. In case of you want to correct the data, that will be simple process, simple principle is to do the single line and cross out and sign and date again. Audit trail of the data. So we, in case of electronic system, we should have the records of all the first date and time, second record date and time, third record date and time. So we can also export that audit trail from the system, and we check who performed the entry and who modified the entry after the first one. There are correction, but no reason for change. That is also important. So users should always provide the reason for the change, because without reason, we should not tell that that data has been changed intentionally or unintentionally, right? So reason should be there. This just means about we should not use like white out to hide the data, fine? And this is about the overwritten. So we should not change the data like this 78. Now coming to the contemporaneous. Contemporaneous means it should be data should be recorded on the same time. So we should not rely on our memory. Fine. So for example, I'm recording the vital sign now and I will just remember that. I will think then I will record all the vital signs together, maybe at the time, evening time, or maybe after 2 days. So that is not a good practice. So all the data should be recorded on the similar same time. Why it is important? Because backdating gives the false impression that task has been done in a timely manner or not. Because you are, if you are doing or you are recording the data which is generated today and you are recording data yesterday, sorry, tomorrow and after day after tomorrow, it means you are doing the backdating documentation. That is a wrong practice. And you can't remember all the data and that is a false impression of the data, maybe wrong vital sign recording or physical examination. While reviewing or observing the data, we should see that data recorded by person not performing the task, whether it is performed, recorded data is performed by the authorized person or not. Records are free from error. If you are doing the backdating or you are relying on the memory, then there will be a chance of error. And we may also check attendance record are equally important. So attendance records means if subject is housed in the facility, then you can check the what is the time of ICF. So if time of ICF is before the housing or any data generator authorized by the person, staff person or subject, so we can test out that particular data is generated before the person is housed. Data should be in the original format. It should be original or maybe certified copy, true copy. We should use the official document only. We should not write the data on simple paper. The simple paper should have just basic information about the project, about the sponsor name, the things, maybe CRO, so who are generating the data, maybe site name. And don't use scrap paper for the documents. Obviously, we will not use that, but we should avoid this kind of written the raw data as original or as true copy. So all the data which is generated during the course of the study should be retained in some point of time. We should have the facility about the archiving. So it should be kept as a well-maintained file. Why it is important? Data may be lost or maybe afterwards, it could be incomplete. If we lost, then there is incomplete data. If inspector want to trace the entire study, then in case we missed some data, then there'll be incompleteness of the data. It may result in the transcription or data entry error. When reviewing, we should see whether the particular form is control copy or uncontrol copy. If control copy, that should not be changed in the content of the metadata. If it is uncontrol copy, it may be modified based on the project specific comment. We should also check about the missing data. Yeah. Next is about that accuracy or accurate, whether data is accurate or not. In this, what is the message for the accuracy? Accuracy is no error or editing performed without documenting or while amending the document. Should represent the accurately entered and completely reports all required data. Do not test in the compliance. So we should not testing that is compliance or non-compliance. So data should be always be in the compliant manner. If you are using some instrument, it should be calibrated, it should be maintained and validated as per the validation documents. Because based on that, we are getting the results. So all these machines, instruments should be validated. It will get out of the specific result. So in case of any result is out of range, too much outlier, then we should recheck whether a particular investigation is result is appropriate or not. That might be a transcription error. Why it is important? So good and accurate data provides the basis of good scientific decision. If there is an inaccurate data, it will waste money as well as study and efforts behind that. When reviewing the data, results that are too good to be true, no, it could be false. So too much too good result, that might be a concern on that data, because error should always be happen on a particular study. So all the, if all the data is correct, there is no any error, so there is something wrong. So we should check whether that all the data is accurate or not. So always be in the doubtful manner. Or detail of repeat test to see the data records. So it might happen to a person may hide the insignificant reports, and they may just avoid that report and retest the records, and retest the lab test, and then present that latest lab reports. And that is may be suitable with the protocol. But we should check whether sample is retested or not, if what happened with the previously collected samples, okay, about the missing data. Now coming to the plus. Previously, it was only Alcoa. Now it is plus. Plus include the complete records, that all record data requires an audit trail to show nothing has been deleted or lost. Right? Consistent. This primarily means ensuring that the data is in a chronological order, like date of visit of screening visit should be after the date of ICF. So it should not be before the ICF, and all other following activity like for screening visit, like what date of vital, date of physical exam, date of sample collection should be after the date of visit. We should always ensure the chronological of the data. This is just example date, but that is various way. So it should be in line with the protocol. How the protocol define the activity sequence. So it should be on that manner. Enduring, so and this will ensure that data is available for a longer time, maybe in the decades. Normally up to 15 years, we should keep the data, maybe in the physical manner or maybe in the archiving soft copy, electronic format. It should be available at any point of time, because inspection might be happen at after study at any point of time, right? And the most efficient way to achieving this is normally by recording data electronically. So normally what happen, data is getting generated on the paper at the site, and that all the data is transcribed on the electronic system that we call as electronic data capture system, EDC. So that maintain the data up to the expected duration into the electronic format, and that is taken, backup is taken periodically to ensure that all the data is available without any loss. And that vendor, like what developing the EDC, are responsible to maintain the data. Just reiterating the last session words. Just remember, or maybe always remember, what is not documented is not done. So if you are presenting data which are not in the source document, it means it is that data is not generated. So it is remember that we should document all the things which are executed or performed during the study, and document what is done as well as what is not done. So some activities supposed to be done, but maybe due to oversight it miss out, like physical examination miss out. So it should be documented like as a protocol deviation. So it is not just to record what is done, but we should also document what is not done in the study. Yeah, I am done with my presentation. If you have any question or question, then I'm happy to answer.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Dheeraj Patel. It was really, really knowledgeable and helpful, because it is very depth into the clinical research. The Alcoa Plus Okay, the last time we didn't get the chance to get the things in depth, but this time we are very happy that we learned so many things. Over to Pavan Sharma sir for last few lines, and we will open this session for the question answer if anyone wants to.
I would like to request Professor Madan Thangvelu ji for his concluding remarks in 5 minutes, because we have to start second webinar also at 3:50 p.m.
Pavan ji, namaskar ji, greetings, greetings from Cambridge. Thank you for this wonderful session. All the three speakers were very exciting. Ravi Shankar ji's presentation had so much information, talking about bitter receptors. And what I found missing there a little bit was the integrity with the tattvics principles, the tattvas of Ayurveda. You gave us some aspects on how the regulations, how to see a little more integration with the deeper tattvas, so Panchabhuta Siddhanta, Tridosha Siddhanta, how to design studies that are consistent with, say, Kriyakala stages or aspects of Saptadhatu or Agni and those kind of details. I hope you have laid, all of you have today laid a foundation which can be used to get to the next level for our students, because a lot of students now, yesterday I'm discussing now with a new MD student at Kottagal, at the college, Ayurveda College in Kottagal. And we have a simple question here, which is diabetic polyneuropathy, which is a major problem in all parts of the world where diabetes is. And the question is, will Udvartana be helpful for relieving the symptoms of diabetic polyneuropathy? So I give this as one example where we can apply all the presentations that we ever that we had today on that one question. How will we design an experiment to understand the effect of Udvartana using any of the churnas? It doesn't matter which churna, whichever is the churna you decide. How will we design an experiment and document the results using the Alcoa principles too? So to be consistent with what Ravi Shankar ji gave, be consistent with what Pavan ji, you offered us in terms of the Ayurveda regulations, et cetera, and in terms of the Alcoa principles. So we have a lot of young students now coming to that stage where we can bring this transformation, you see. The criticism from everybody around the world is, where is the evidence? Now, it is a criticism. And as Dheeraj ji presented in his very last stage, if it is not recorded, it doesn't exist. So we keep saying Panchakarma is going on every day. We are doing 100,000 Panchakarmas in India, but nothing is recorded. So how to bring about this transformation? I look forward to all of us here. Munshi ji is here with us. We can take this into the world of Unani medicine also. I don't see a Siddha person here with us. So Pavan ji, that is another job for us, to bring Siddha people on the platform.
Sure.
And also the yoga people on the platform, because at the end of the day, everything is connected to Panchabhuta Siddhanta. Everything is connected with Tridosha Siddhanta. So, and we get different perspectives from different areas. The Unani perspective is very important for us, because there is, if we look at the overlap between Ayurveda and Unani, you see a lot of overlap that was recognized hundreds of years ago in the Tibia College in Delhi. You see, if you look at the Tibia College, at the time of the Mughal emperors, there was a desire among the Hakim, the emperor's Hakim, to show this overlap between Ayurveda and Unani. And that is a fight that we haven't quite resolved. We haven't understood. If we look at the TKDL, Traditional Digital Knowledge Library, that is there, about 300,000 formulations are there. And within those 300,000 formulations are very rich formulations from the Unani system. There are more Unani formulations in that database for so many conditions. And we need to make a dialogue in this space. So today's presentation, Pavanji and all of you, is a very important initiative. What you have taken here is a very, very important initiative. I hope when Pavanji organizes the next event, we will bring in the Siddha people also, because Siddha right now in the context of the ongoing COVID crisis, they have at least two formulations that uses andrograph spaniculata, you know, which is Kabasur Kudineer and Nilavembu Kudineer. And we want to understand, because they have bitter principles in them, you know, they are Katutiktarasa rich formulations. Yes. So we need to go into that space with some detail based on all the information that was given to us today. The Kabasur Kudineer, Nilavem Kudineer, is being experimented in South Africa.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But we don't. Yes. So Pavanji's challenge is to also to bring people from South Africa into our discussions, you see. So we want to see all, and within homeopathy also, we need people in here. Pavanji, so this is when we talk about independent research ethics, we must bring all the Ayush modalities here, you know. And this platform must remain. Ayush Darpan Foundation must take that effort now. In one of my previous presentations, I said that every year we must find a home, either in Udupi or in Uttarakhand, a place for a conference on this nature. So Pavanji's initiative must extend into an annual conference.
Sure.
Maybe
sure,
between sure, Udupi sure, sure. 1 year and in Uttarakhand the next year, you know, on just this principle, on this thing, all the Ayush systems to come together. So I'm very excited, Pavanji, for your wonderful initiative today. And to all of you who have presented today, it is an eye-opener. Particularly, Dheeraj's presentation was so clear. And Dheeraj, your comments were very, very wonderful, very clear presentation. And I hope you will be part of this core team that we are informally connected with to take forward and to guide us in making recommendations, in designing databases for our studies. So I feel very excited, Pavanji, that you have brought all of us together. And Joshi ji also in Ayush Darpan, very, very important that you have so much energy to keep these events going. And if I think we have enough energy here now to say, okay, here is our first annual Congress on Ayush designs, ethical experimental design in Ayush, to be held at the Uttarakhand Ayurveda University. Let us host it there, you know, and let us see people like Munshi ji we have to bring into our story. The Ayush Valley Foundation will be very excited to bring an international dimension also into this study.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bora.
Pavanji, if you can also get some feedback from Munshi ji, it's difficult to catch Munshi ji. If he can also give us a few words of inspiration, then it will be wonderful.
Dr. Munshi ji.
Surely, sir. Surely, sir. Surely, sir. Just a minute. I am just out of the room. It is raining over here very heavily. Dr. Pavanji knows it. I am highly thankful of Dr. Madanji, who has snatched words from my mouth regarding the basic fundamentals of the Ayush, which we are lacking. And he is right in that direction.
Munshiji, I want to make
whenever
one,
we go
from the... Munshiji, I want to interrupt here with just one comment, you know. I forgot, from the Unani formulation, we have a very important formulation that we are studying now, which is Arke Azeeb. So Arke Azeeb has three ingredients, three plants, kafur, ajwain, and pudina. And these three formulations are very important for us because it is opening
up. Amrit Dhara also, sir, Amrit Dhara.
Amrit Dhara. So here is a dialogue, you see, and you also have, just like Chyawanprash, you have a very nice formulation in your formulary. I want to hear.
As you told that Arke Ajeeb, it is really Ajeeb. It gives you relief from the dahiyas. It gives you relief from the stomachache. It gives you relief from the viral infections. It relieves the congestion of the chest, congestion of the nose. It is really ajeeb. It acts in multiple ways. We are also studying on it as a method for relieving the COVID-like symptoms, and we have succeeded in that. But the main point which I wanted to discuss, and you had already pointed on that how far we are doing justice with our system by getting animal studies done, preclinical studies, toxicological studies, how far we are doing this justice, because we know we have the
basic fundamentals. Sorry to interrupt you. For that, please join after 10 minutes. Next webinar is there. Ayurveda needs more justified focus. Today is International Justice Day.
No, I just want to conclude in just 2 minutes' time that in animal studies, we don't know whether the animals having basic temperament, which we believe, or vat, pit, kaph. How can we say that animals are in vat variety, kaph variety, or it is in pit variety, or it is in temperament of sodavi, safravi? How can it be possible? And number two is the extraction of the molecule. We believe in whole herb concept. You can take example of Rolfia serpentina and rizarpine. Rizarpine proved very much toxic, while as Rolfia serpentina is still going on for the hypertension. So this is the way that we are deviating from our fundamentals. Why don't we tell the world that you believe on us? We will take research in our own fundamental way. We don't take care of the, let us not take into consideration the modern scientific technology, modern scientific rules, what they say, because they don't believe in our basics. They will never believe in that. But we have to present, we have to validate, as Dr. Madanji really told, that we have to validate our own basics. Whatever 5,000 years Charaka has said, whatever 1,000 years back Avicenna has told, let us correlate with that, and let us get to something which world will accept. That is what I wish you should tell to the phone. Thank you very much for giving me the time. Thank you very much. Pawanji, thank you.
Great, sir, but kindly join next session also. Great, great concept.
I have pharmacovigilance program from Patna. I may have to join that because I am coordinator of pharmacovigilance center Calcutta. So great. I'll see if I can join. I'll see definitely.
Yunshiji, thank you for your kind words. Accept everything. We look forward to discussing it.
Thank you very much.
Very good afternoon, everybody. We thank you all for joining for this webinar. Since we are presenting this webinar on the researches in Ayush stream, so from Dr. Ravi Shankar sir, Dr. Pawan Sharma sir, what we got to know the fundamentals, what we need is to be needed in the circumstances, and how to go forward in this Ayush research schemes and everything. So this is just the starting, and today's webinar was all about getting to know how we can go forward with the Ayush researches. So our next series will be all about the research methodologies, the Ayush schemes, how we can be able to do the researches, and we'll be discussing thoroughly about the methodology and everything. So today's session, I am very much thankful to Dr. Ravi Shankar sir, Dr. Pawan Sharma sir, Dr. Dhiraj, Dr. Madan sir, Dr. Munshi sir, and all the distinguished guests.
Oh, audio went off.
Audio and video.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you all.
Thank you, everybody. And
please meet in next webinar on WebEx.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. More of our web series regarding this. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Hari Om. Darshan ji.